The major treatment approach in treatment of diabetes is to control blood glucose level. Most commonly, in a newly diagnosed type 2 diabetes, as a first-line drug, we use metformin. But with the second-line drugs, we have a few options. And one of the agents that we can use in treatment of diabetes as a second-line option is the drugs called sulfonylureas. Sulfonylureas have several benefits. They are relatively efficient, generally they have good treatment adherence, they provide efficient stimulation of beta cells, and they have good tolerability. But the major benefit is their price, it's a relatively cheap drug. The reason why sulfonylureas can cause increase in insulin secretion is their ability to close ATP-sensitive potassium channels. On this picture, we can see an overview of their mechanism of action. But for a better understanding, we will discuss their mechanism of action step by step. And to explain it, we have to recall physiology of pancreatic beta cells. So, here we have pancreatic beta cell. Beta cells have GLUT1 transporter. This transporter provides transportation of glucose into the cell. Also, they have ATP-sensitive potassium channels. And we have to know that in rest state, potassium channels are opened. So, because potassium is intracellular ion, which means that the concentration of potassium inside the cell is much higher than the concentration of potassium outside the cell, while potassium channels are opened, potassium constantly leaves cell. Also, beta cells have voltage-gated calcium channels. And in rest state, calcium channels are closed. So calcium, which is extracellular ion, in rest state, cannot enter into the cell. Also, beta cells have intracellular vesicles. And intracellular vesicles have already formed insulin and C-peptide. When glucose enters into the beta cell, glucose undergoes phosphorylation by glucokinase to glucose-6-phosphate. Glucose-6-phosphate undergoes glycolysis with subsequent degradation in Krebs cycle and electron transport chain that results in production of ATP molecules. ATP molecules activate ATP-sensitive potassium channels. With activation, potassium channels close. If potassium channels close, potassium begins to accumulate inside the cell. With increase in positively charged potassium ions, membrane potential increase. For example, from minus 70, membrane potential increase to minus 50. And the state when membrane potential becomes more positive, we call depolarization. And depolarization triggers activation of voltage-gated calcium channels. If calcium channels open, calcium by concentration gradient begin to enter into the cell. And increasing intracellular calcium triggers exocytosis of vesicle, with release of insulin and C-peptide into the blood. The fate of C-peptide is rather prosaic. C-peptide incomes to the kidneys, and kidneys excrete C-peptide from the organism into the urine. Insulin in the blood stimulates tissues to consume more glucose. And because glucose begins to income to the tissues, glucose level in the blood decreases. In addition to this, beta cells have GLP-1 receptor, which provides regulation of insulin secretion. Glucagon-like peptide 1 in the blood binds to GLP-1 receptor. With binding, receptor becomes activated. Activation of GLP-1 receptor stimulates closing of potassium channels and opening of calcium channels. As a result, more calcium molecules income to the cell. And with increasing intracellular calcium level, exocytosis of insulin increase. Interesting that the amount of glucagon-like peptide in the blood is controlled by a specific enzyme called dipeptidyl peptidase 4. This enzyme provides inactivation of glucagon-like peptide. In simple words, DPP4 destroys GLP-1 molecules. If we prescribe sulfonylureas, they provide blockage of potassium channels. With additional blockage of potassium channels, more potassium ions will remain inside the beta cell. The higher the amount of intracellular potassium ions, the higher becomes membrane potential, and thereby the stronger will be the depolarization of beta cells. Increasing depolarization causes additional opening of calcium channels. This allows more calcium ions to enter inside the beta cell. And with increasing intracellular calcium, exocytosis of insulin and C-peptide into the blood increase. Increasing insulin stimulates tissues to uptake more glucose from the blood. As a result, blood glucose level decrease. Also important that with increasing C-peptide in the blood, the excretion of C-peptide by the kidneys into the urine increase. It's important because by excretion of C-peptide, we can monitor how much insulin beta cells secrete into the blood. Sulfonylureas are one of the oldest medications in treatment of diabetes. They were discovered even before metformin. We can classify sulfonylureas by generations. On second generation, so-called conventional, and third generation, so-called modern. And also, we can classify them based on duration of their effect, on short-acting, immediate, and long-acting. The most common conventional drugs are glibenclamide, gliclazide, and glipizide. They all belong to a second generation. The modern sulfonylureas are glimepiride, glipizide with extended release, and gliclazide with modified release. Generally, all modern sulfonylureas have a lesser amount of side effects, so they are safer options. According to most modern guidelines, in patients with diabetes, sulfonylureas should be the last option in case of cardiovascular and renal disease. And the only benefit that they have is the cheap price. But according to other sources, sulfonylureas are not that bad. For years, the most common scenario when we prescribe sulfonylureas was the combination of sulfonylurea and metformin in case if we cannot achieve target glycemic control with metformin alone. The reason why they are so effective in combination with metformin is their very different mechanism of action. So metformin and sulfonylureas has a very good synergy. One of the major problems with sulfonylureas is their side effects. They have two major side effects. It's hypoglycemia and weight gain. Sulfonylureas have a higher risk of hypoglycemia compared to other diabetic medications. Generally, all drugs that stimulate B cells to produce more insulin have a higher risk of hypoglycemia. It's important because major hypoglycemic episodes are considered a strong indicator of poor prognosis among diabetic patients. Among sulfonylureas, gliclazide has a lowest risk of major hypoglycemic episodes. The patients where hypoglycemia as a side effect becomes extremely important are Muslims during Ramadan. Because prolonged fasting combined with increasing glucose uptake due to a high insulin level can easily cause hypoglycemia. The second side effect of most sulfonylureas is weight gain. Weight gain as a side effect can be a problem in diabetes type 2, where patients are already obese. But some studies imply that there is no direct evidence of weight gain, especially with glucosamine. As we already know, sulfonylureas are relatively effective cheap drugs. They have two major side effects, it's hypoglycemia and weight gain. And what is also important is that, according to previous studies, sulfonylureas can significantly decrease the risk of microvascular complications. It's especially important for renal tissue, because as we know, high blood glucose level can cause diabetic nephropathy. But the problem is that sulfonylureas not only do not help cardiovascular system, they are associated with adverse cardiovascular outcomes. Why it's extremely important? Here we can see a list of diabetic drugs. And if we compare sulfonylureas to SGLT2 inhibitors, as we see, SGLT2 inhibitors have more benefits. They are more potent, they have cardioprotective and nephroprotective effects, which makes a huge difference in diabetes. And the only advantage that sulfonylureas have, it's a price, they are cheap. And as we see from the guidelines, sulfonylureas are tier 2 diabetic drugs to control blood glucose level. So, sulfonylureas since 1950 are used in treatment of diabetes. But nowadays, we have more potent, more safe drugs that are more efficient in controlling of blood glucose level. But still, in some cases, after so many years, we still use them.